Chalk Talk portion of our meeting. Today the subject is stress. I'm calling it Stress Be Gone. And here's what some of the topics we're going to review for you. We're going to define what stress is. There's lots of definitions of stress. We're going to talk what stress does to us physically and emotionally and in our lives. What stress does to you in particular, so we can maybe get a couple of stories. What you can do about it, what the options are, and some of the best options, and strategies to adopt and integrate to manage stress and make some of it go away. You can't get all of it to go away, but you can get some of it to go away. Stress refers to the consequences of the failure of an organism, the human body, us, people, to respond appropriately to emotional or physical threats, whether they are real or imaginary. Now, as an example, suppose one of the doors were to suddenly burst open and a tiger were to run into the room. What would we do? The tiger's in the room, looks hungry. We're going to have a problem. That's a stressful event. And we need to be able to respond to that appropriately. And we're not prepared to do that. The stress affects how we choose to handle the onslaught of demands and decision-making strategies. And we are given those onslaughts all the time. Wherever we go, whatever we do, there's always demands. You have to decide on this. You have to do this. You have to make decisions. And there's never an end to it. So it's always ever-present. Every stress leaves an indelible scar, and the organism pays for its survival after a stressful situation by becoming a little older. Oh, thank you for that, Dr. Hans Seeley. We get older just a little bit as a consequence of every one of these events that has some significance. It ages us. It tears us down a peg or two. Hans Seeley, MD, PhD, an endocrinologist, Canadian, not his nationality wasn't Canadian, he developed something called GAS, the General Adaptation Syndrome, a general theory of stress. He died in 82. When I was doing psychotherapy as a profession primarily in my days in Palo Alto, I opened my practice after being in community mental health for 5 years. And I didn't want to just have an empty office because no one knew I was going to be involved in my practice. So I decided to specialize in something that I could market. So I went to my local bookstores and I looked at the self-help section of the bookstores to see what the most popular item was at that time. And there were a lot of writings about Hans Seeley, about stress. So in my mind, I decided, aha, executive stress management, that's what I will specialize in, because I could market that. So I picked that topic. And I simply made flyers and stuck them onto the doors of the other people in my building. I was in a four-story building in downtown Palo Alto. And in the building next door, which was a bank, and the building across the street, which was a bank, that had offices in those places. And surprise, surprise, my phone rang. People said, I understand you are an expert in stress. I'm stressed. Can I come see you? I said, sure. And that's how I started my practice. Because at that time, stress management, because of the work of this gentleman, was a hot item, and there were lots of books and lots of things going on about it. So thank you, Hans, for getting me started in my psychotherapy practice. GAS has three stages. When the tiger comes into the room, the first stage is alarm. Oh my God, there's a tiger. The second stage is resistance. It can't be. That's impossible. I'm hallucinating. And the third stage is after we run around to try to get away from the tiger and we watch the tiger eat poor Scott because someone has shoved Scott into the tiger, we're exhausted. That's what stress does to us. It alerts us. We have to respond and we resist responding because we don't want to change. We like doing what we're doing. And then that can be exhausting. Because stress is caused by some existing factor or stressor, the little bee, see, looking at the bee, and then the bee moves on, but the dude is now feeling anxiety. He's got a little wrinkle in his forehead. He's a little worried. Where is the next bee going to come from? I'm worried about that. So it's not just over. There's an aftermath. Stress symptoms. Gosh, there's lots of them. A state of alarm and adrenaline production. Short-term resistance as a coping mechanism. I can't believe this is happening again. Exhaustion. irritability, muscular tension, headaches, inability to concentrate. I mean, look at the list. A variety of psychological reactions, depression, elevated heart rate, and disease. So that's what happened. There, I'm a little stressed out right now. And he says, just turn around and leave quietly and no one gets hurt. That's what don't be around me, I'm all stressed out. Everybody ever feel that way?
Sure.
All the hands are up. Yeah, sure, okay. Stress exhausts our intellectual capital, our ability to think. We just react, and it wears us out and tears us down, and we're exhausted. And then if we have to solve a problem, I think I'll look at that tomorrow, because I'm beat. I'm going to go home and sleep like for 2 days. Happens. Here's the brain, a very crude picture of the brain. This is the executive functioning part up here in the front. This is the back part back here. This is the fight or flight part back here. Stress gets us up here and causes us to engage that part. Tiger comes in, we see the tiger, and we run like hell. Okay. The executive functioning of the brain regulates decision-making and judgment and planning and moral reasoning and a sense of self. All those things, we really, really need those things. And we need them to be functioning well most of the time. We want them to be functioning well most of the time. Working memory is that ability to hold information, and it's limited. And we need that for complex tasks and reasoning and so on and so forth. And that's minimized by stress. The tasks of working memory require goal orientation, monitoring of activities and so forth, manipulation of information, and behaviors in the face of these interfering things that we didn't anticipate or don't like. So stress clogs up working memory. And I'm not talking now about tigers. I'm talking about stress from normal work. Under stress, mild stress, chronic stress, repeated stress, there's not enough room in the front for creative thinking and problem solving, because it's all in the back for running away. So we do get tired, and we want to sleep a lot, and there's no energy to cope with doubt, and there's doubt. Remember, doubt is fatal to power, and we're going to have doubt. And there's complexity. There's always complexity. And we feel isolated. Gee, nobody else has the same problems with stress that I do. I must be the only one. So what do? We isolate ourselves even more because we can't cope. It just gets worse and worse and worse. Not good. If we allow high doses of stress to disengage our executive functioning, we suffer the consequences. No, it says, if we allow. In other words, there's a choice. We can understand stress and work around the terrible consequences of stress once we understand that that's possible. If you don't do that, you'll have impulsive, short-sighted, even maybe violent behavior happen to you. You'll do that. You'll break something, you'll hit somebody. You'll have anxiety, and you may feel depressed. You may adjust, abuse substances, even chocolate or pizza. Your learning and memory is impaired. I can't remember anything. I can't learn anything. I'm too old to learn anything anymore. My life is too stressful. And susceptibility to disease and even death. And if you get really ill, then you're more likely to get even iller. Is iller a word? Left unchecked, high stress pounds on us relentlessly. And we wonder, why am I feeling how I'm feeling? And you think about, well, let me review my life for a little while. I've had a lot of stressful events, which I did nothing to relieve or ameliorate. So I'm allowing this to happen to myself. I need to step back and take care of some things in my life so I can be less stressed. We can worry about these all the time, because it's a ticking time bomb, can be. All right. Partly a long time ago, as people started looking at this, they decided and proved, and I'm going to get to that in just a minute, that stress can cause all these kinds of things to happen to us. And we don't want these kinds of things. I mean, we certainly don't want high stress to give us heart disease, stroke, high blood pressure, irritability, depression, diabetes, sex problems, insomnia, fatigue, overeating. How many people overeat when they're stressed? All the hands go up. Or overdrink, drink too much, yeah. I have asthma. I've had asthma since I was a kid. That gets worse under stress. And these other kinds of things. We don't want this stuff to happen. So it has been written that stress is the nation's number one killer.